Hi, I'm Mary. I'm an environmental consultant. This video today is part of my ammonia emissions from agriculture series. Around 90% of ammonia emissions are from agriculture, including applying organic manures. This includes slurry, manure, digestate and biosolids. Today I'm going to talk about different application options for reducing ammonia emissions during application to land. Traditionally, slurry has been applied with a broadcast spreader, also called a splash plate, where the slurry is forced under pressure through a nozzle and onto the field. DEFRA's Clean Air Strategy states that by 2025, farmers will be expected to use low emission spreading equipment, so splash plates will no longer be allowed. For now, if you can't avoid using a splash plate and you're spreading on bare soil, one option is to incorporate the slurry or digestate into the soil immediately after application and at the latest within 12 hours, such as using a disc or a tine cultivator. This diagram shows what happens during and after organic manures have been surface broadcast. I have taken slurry as an example with the same principle for all organic manures. The spraying mixes the slurry with air, and once the slurry lands on the ground, it all ends up on the soil or the crop surface, so it's still exposed to the air. The ammonium nitrogen, NH4+, in the slurry reacts with the air, forming ammonia, with up to 80% of the available nitrogen applied being lost to the atmosphere in the form of ammonia. There's also the risk of surface runoff into water, especially if it rains. More ammonia will be released on warm and windy days, and also when the slurry remains on the surface. This means even less nitrogen remains in the slurry to fertilise the crops. So to reduce ammonia emissions and retain nitrogen for crop use, it's best to apply slurry digestate and other liquid organic manures during cool and low wind conditions. As I mentioned, in some countries going forward, splash plates will no longer be allowed. Instead, the range of low emission spreading equipment will be the only options for farmers. These all work by decreasing the surface area which is exposed to the air. This can be achieved by spreading the material in strips directly on the soil surface using a band spreader, as you saw in the diagram just now, or placing material beneath the soil surface using an injector. By doing this, more nitrogen makes it into the soil and less is able to react with the air to form ammonia. This diagram shows the two scenarios. On the left, the manure or slurry has been surface broadcast, with a lot of ammonia being emitted. And on the right, the slurry has been applied with a low emission spreading technique, such as an injector or trailing shoe. As ammonia volatilisation occurs from the slurry surface, applying the same volume of slurry in narrow bands rather than as an overall broadcast surface cover will reduce the surface area to volume ratio of the applied slurry, reducing the area from which emissions can occur. So, reducing the surface area of the spread slurry that is exposed to the air will minimise ammonia losses. Here, the slurry has been applied to a crop. Where a crop canopy is present, a lot of broadcast slurry will sit on top of the crop, as shown on the left, in full contact with the air, with lots of ammonia released. With low emissions spreading on the right, the slurry will be applied below the canopy. The canopy will provide a physical barrier where reduced air movement and temperatures at the soil surface will all reduce ammonia emissions. Now let's think about these low emission methods in a bit more detail. There are different techniques suited to solid and liquid outputs. Firstly, solid manure and solid digestate and other organic manures. Here, rapid soil incorporation following application to tillage land will reduce emissions. For liquid slurry and digestate, there are more options. Band spreading application methods such as a trailing hose or trailing shoe, and also injection techniques can effectively reduce ammonia emissions. I will go through these methods now. Firstly, the trailing hose, also known as a band spreader or dribble bar. This is generally suitable for grassland and arable land where the slope is less than 15%. The trailing hose can be used on solid seeded crops, and wide units may be compatible with tram lines. Hoses are connected to the boom of the spreader. The slurry or digestate is placed in narrow bands on the soil surface via trailing hoses. For arable crops, using a trailing hose rather than broadcasting extends the window for slurry application later into the spring, when crop height would normally exclude conventional surface broadcast slurry application. The trailing hose method can achieve a 30 to 35% reduction in ammonia emissions compared to broadcasting slurry. So, the trailing shoe is also known as a band spreader. This can be suitable for grassland, arable land ahead of drilling, and for row crops. As you can see on the top photo, there are metal forward-placing shoes. These ride along the soil surface, parting any grass or crop present, so that the liquid organic manure is placed on the soil below the grass sward or crop canopy. The trailing shoe can achieve a 30 to 60% reduction in ammonia emissions compared to broadcast slurry. So just thinking about these two band spreading techniques that I've just mentioned, the trailing hose and the trailing shoe. Ammonia reduction efficiencies for slurry spreading are typically 30% for the trailing hose and trailing shoe equipment when grass is short, and 60% for trailing shoe equipment when the grass is long, that being over 10 centimetres compared to broadcast application. Of course, ammonia reductions can vary. And the next technique is injection. Injectors can achieve a 70 to 90% reduction in ammonia emissions compared to broadcast slurry. There are various types of injector, which are classed as either shallow or deep, purely based on how deep the liquid organic manure is placed in the soil. This photo shows a shallow injector. Shallow injectors are suitable for arable and grassland, and they have discs which cut 4 to 6 centimetres deep in narrow slots into the soil, into which the slurry is deposited. The slots are usually 25 to 30 centimetres apart. Shallow injection is usually not feasible on stony soils and also heavy clay soil in the summer, when the soil is very dry and hard. Ammonia emissions can be reduced by about 70%. And then the deep injector. These are best suited to arable land due to the damage that can occur to grass or crops. Deep injectors cut slots into the ground 10 to 30 centimetres deep, usually spaced around 50 centimetres apart. Deep injectors should be avoided during the summer months and not used until the soil has sufficiently dried in the spring, so it's not too wet. So they should only be used when the soil is sufficiently dry, but not in very dry conditions, especially in high clay soils with over 35% clay. And deep injection is also not likely to be suitable when there are field drains. They're also very limited by soil texture, moisture and stone content, and are not suitable on slopes over 15%. The good news is that deep injectors can reduce ammonia emissions by around 90%. Logistics, thinking about how to get the slurry to the field and hooked up to the spreading equipment. With a conventional tanker, as shown in the top photo, slurry spreading is a batch process, as the tractor needs to return to the slurry store to refill when it's empty. On the other hand, the umbilical method is shown on the bottom photo. This involves pumping the liquid slurry or digestate from the store, be it a lagoon or tank, using a high-pressure pump unit via a pipeline to a tractor-mounted applicator unit. Once the umbilical system is set up and the pipeline has been laid, the pump is started and the applicator unit is then driven in straight lines. The supply pipe, also known as the drag hose, is pulled up and down the field. Umbilical systems have a number of advantages compared to a tanker: higher work rates, lower spreading cost per hectare, and much less soil compaction, as there are no heavy tankers. Also, as the supply of slurry or digestate is continually flowing, the slurry is spread without having to travel from store to field for a refill. This table compares the different application techniques I've just been talking about. Firstly, thinking about the dry matter content of the slurry or digestate. For the trailing hose, DEFRA guidance suggests a maximum of 9% dry matter, with 6% for the other low emission application techniques. This is half of what is suitable for surface broadcasting. Any system that involves pumping slurry through relatively small bore pipes will be prone to blockages, With these low emission techniques, removing any solids that might cause a blockage may be necessary. This can be achieved by mechanical separation of slurry or by agitating it. And the work rate of surface broadcasting is the fastest, with brand spreading slightly slower and injecting the slowest method. In contrast, all of the low emission techniques have the benefit of much more uniform spreading of the slurry or digestate compared to broadcasting. Also, by applying the slurry in rows as closely as possible to the roots, where it's needed the most, this gives the crop the best chance of acquiring the nutrients from the slurry or digestate. Levels of ammonia emissions and odour are also shown here, relative to surface broadcast application. This is with the assumption that the slurry is not incorporated after spreading. This clearly shows the reduction in ammonia emissions with all four techniques, with injection being the most effective at reducing ammonia emissions during liquid slurry and digestate spreading. The capital cost of all low emission spreading kit is higher than surface broadcasting. This here is just an indication from DEFRA showing the trailing hose to be generally the cheapest of these options, with deep injection being the most expensive. Here are a few thoughts on changing from using a splash plate to low emission spreading. The most effective application type may not be appropriate for the land. As an example, small irregular shaped fields may present difficulties for large machines, and hilly terrain or stony dry soils may prevent the use of some other types of kit. In some cases, it may be more cost effective to use a contractor who may have one or even more different types of equipment, so can tailor what they use to your land. If buying new equipment is the best approach for you, it may be worth seeking advice first to make sure what you choose is suitable for your land and the production type, be it grassland, arable or horticulture. It's also worth keeping an eye out for financial support. For example, in England, there are sometimes grants such as the Countryside Productivity Scheme and LEADER. In summary, there are a range of benefits to switching from a splash plate to low emission spreading options. This includes reduced odour and more nitrogen stays in the slurry or digestate, so there should be less inorganic fertiliser inputs. Low emission kit makes spreading slurry and digestate on growing cereals an option, with more uniform spreading. And of course, one key benefit is the reduction in ammonia emissions compared with broadcasting. Here are some useful links to further information going into more detail on organic manure spreading options. And finally, I have some more videos in this farm ammonia reduction series, including my general overview of ammonia emissions from agriculture. My other videos, including this one today, together consider how to reduce ammonia emissions in each step of livestock production in more detail. Let me know what topics you feel would be useful, especially related to sustainable food production. Thanks for listening today.